A little over 2 decades ago, the only planets we knew of were the ones within our own solar system. Yet now, we have found thousands of exoplanets just within our Milky Way galaxy. And with so many of them to explore, there are bound to be a few weird ones. And these 5 exoplanets that we're going to explore in this video are so unusual that they absolutely exceed our wildest imaginations. Exoplanets, short for extrasolar planets, are planets that exist outside of our solar system, and the first ones were found back in 1992. Since then, as of filming this today, on the 8th of June 2024, we have confirmed the existence of 5,638 exoplanets, with thousands more candidates yet to be confirmed. So, there's a lot of them out there, and I searched through the entire list of exoplanets to find the weirdest and wildest ones, and I think I've narrowed it down to what I think are the 5 most wild exoplanets in existence. Let's learn about them. First up is KELT-9b, the hottest exoplanet. This planet is so hot that it rips molecules apart. Like, you wouldn't even find water here, not just because the temperature has evaporated it all into vapor, but because the sheer temperature rips the hydrogen atoms from the oxygen in every water molecule. KELT-9b is classed as a hot Jupiter, and what makes this planet so hot is a combination of 2 things. Number 1, KELT-9b orbits stupidly close to its star. Take Mercury for example, it's the closest planet to the Sun, orbiting at a distance of about 60 million kilometers. Because it's so close to the Sun, it reaches a top temperature of around 430 degrees Celsius. KELT-9b, however, gets a little hotter than Mercury because it orbits around its parent star 10 times closer than Mercury does around the Sun. But it's not just its proximity to its parent star that makes KELT-9b so hot. On top of that, it orbits around a pretty damn hot star, KELT-9. KELT-9b is classed as a B9.5-A0 type star. But what does that even mean? Time for a quick lesson on how we classify stars. Now, stars are generally classed by their spectral type, where different classes of stars will have different patterns in their spectra. And these patterns change significantly with temperature. The hottest stars have few features in their spectra, whereas cooler stars have more complicated patterns. And this modern system of classifying stars, the Harvard classification system, was largely developed by Harvard computer Annie Jump Cannon, and it has been in use for more than 100 years now. KELT-9b is pretty high up on that list, being on the cusp of the second and third hottest categories with a surface temperature of 10,170 Kelvin. That is hot enough to cook a frozen chicken in 78 yoctoseconds. So since KELT-9b orbits really close to a pretty hot star, that causes the daytime temperature to reach a whopping 4,600 Kelvin. That is almost as hot as the surface of the Sun, making KELT-9b the hottest exoplanet discovered so far. But before we finish with our first wild exoplanet, it's time to enter the bonus fact zone. KELT-9b was a little cheeky planet for scientists because its atmosphere was larger than initially expected. And it turns out that the atmosphere of KELT-9b puffs up like a balloon because of the tremendous amount of radiation and heat it cops from its parent star. Now, while KELT-9b is wildly hot, I think we can do better on the absolute wild scale. So let's bring on the next wild exoplanet. Next up is WASP-121b. The planet that rains engagement rings? Okay, not exactly fully formed engagement rings, that would truly be wild, but trust me, this exoplanet is crazy. WASP-121b is quite similar to KELT-9b in that it's another hot Jupiter exoplanet, although not quite as hot with a top temperature of 3,300 Kelvin, but that's still hot enough for this planet to have clouds made of liquid metal, and those liquid metal clouds rain down liquid rubies and sapphires. Now I know what you're thinking, but how? How do we know this? After all, this exoplanet is 850 light years away. Technically, we don't know that it rains rubies and sapphires on WASP-121b, but ruby and sapphire rain is the current best explanation of our observations of this exoplanet. This is how science works, after all. But then that begs the question, how? Let me explain. Now, previous observations of WASP-121b using the Hubble Space Telescope unveiled the presence of metals such as iron, magnesium, chromium, and vanadium in the form of gases in the atmosphere of WASP-121b, particularly on its daytime side. And in a more recent study using the Hubble Space Telescope, astronomers were able to get a more in-depth look at its atmosphere. Astronomers watched it do 2 complete laps around its host star, and in doing so were able to analyze the upper atmosphere of the entire planet, looking at both the day side and the night side. In this new study, the team found that it gets cool enough on the nighttime side of the planet for the gaseous metals detected in its atmosphere to condense into clouds. But To their surprise, they didn't find any aluminium or titanium in the upper atmosphere on the nighttime side of WASP 121b, and the likely explanation for this lack of aluminium and titanium is that those metals could have condensed and rained down into deeper layers of the atmosphere of WASP 121b. Now it's time for a quick lesson in chemistry. When aluminium condenses with oxygen, that forms a compound, corundum, and when that's combined with little bits of chromium, iron, titanium, or vanadium, aka the metals that are found in WASP 121b's atmosphere, that makes ruby or sapphire. And that's why these astronomers think it's likely that it rains down liquid ruby and sapphire on the night side of WASP 121b. Hey, a girl can dream. But Kirsten, wait, what the heck is going on here? Well, I'm glad you asked. This animation of WASP 121b shows material being blasted off the face of the planet from the intense stellar winds from its host star. Does that mean there could be rubies and sapphires just floating in space around this planet? As if this planet couldn't get any more wild. Now on to number three, and rightfully so, because this planet, GW Orionis, is a potential circumtriple planet. Now this exoplanet hasn't been confirmed yet, hence potential, so there is a possibility that it may not even exist, but I think that just adds to the intrigue, right? But before we get any further, what is a circumtriple planet? To put it simply, a circumtriple planet is a planet that orbits around three stars all at once. So instead of a planet orbiting around one single star, like we do on Earth, or even a planet orbiting around a single star in a star system that has three stars, like the planets around Proxima Centauri do in the Alpha Centauri star system, GW Orionis is a possible planet that orbits around three stars all at once. Now the GW Orionis star system is a very young star system, with an age of only 1 million years. For comparison, the Sun is a middle-aged 5 billion years old. So this star system is super young, and like many young star systems, it has a disk of dust and gas surrounding it, which is called a protoplanetary disk, which, as the name suggests, that's where planets form. This particular protoplanetary disk is quite complex, with three concentric rings of material, but they're not aligned. They're all at different angles, and the innermost ring wobbles as it spins around. That's weird. Or one might even say, wild. I would. I'm the one who would say that. There's also a big gap in the disk, which is often a telltale sign of a forming planet carving out its orbit, gobbling up debris as it grows. Now, you could be thinking, but Kirsten, couldn't this complex protoplanetary disk be a result of the forces, interactions of the three stars orbiting around each other? And that would be a valid question. However, computer modeling reveals that this gap can't be explained by the motions of the stars in the system. Instead, it is most likely a planet roughly the size of Jupiter carving out that gap. And if it is a planet, it would be the first circumtriple planet ever found. The first planet to orbit three stars all at once. Introducing our next wild exoplanet, TRES 2b, the darkest exoplanet. This planet is so dark that it reflects less than 1% of the light that hits it. Even charcoal reflects light better than this planet. Like, have you heard of Vanta Black? Like, it's the blackest black ever created, and it reflects just 0.035% of light. So TRES 2b is almost as dark as the darkest material ever created. Now TRES 2b is another hot Jupiter, similar to KELT-9b and WASP 121b, and the reason why it's so not reflective could be due to a lack of reflective clouds, just like the ones that make Jupiter so bright. TRES 2b doesn't have these. The reason why it doesn't have reflective clouds could be due to the constant high temperature it experiences from being so close to its host star, but that doesn't fully explain its unique darkness. It could also be due to an abundance of light-absorbing chemicals, such as vaporized sodium and potassium, or gassy titanium oxide, in the atmosphere. But that still doesn't fully explain why TRES 2b is so dark. What a mystery! Although it's not technically completely dark. Now, while it doesn't reflect light, well, like I said, charcoal reflects light better than TRES 2b, it does have a subtle glow to it, because TRES 2b receives a lot of radiation and heat from its parent star because it's in a really tight orbit, which raises its temperature to around 1200 Kelvin, causing it to emit a faint red glow. But as far as reflectiveness goes, TRES 2b is definitely by far the darkest exoplanet we've found so far. Finally, number five. HD 189773b, the exoplanet where it rains molten glass sideways. Imagine if Jupiter were blue and rained molten glass sideways at 8,700 kilometers per hour. Well, that's basically HD189773b. It's another hot Jupiter like KELT-9b and WASP-121b and TREZ-2b, but HD189773b is a special hot Jupiter to scientists because it's the closest hot Jupiter to Earth that passes in front of its star from our perspective, sitting at just 65 light years away. And this gives astronomers a really good view of the planet and allows us to study the atmosphere of HD189773b really well. And thanks to this, astronomers for the first time were able to figure out the colour of an exoplanet with HD189773b. And they did this using the Hubble Space Telescope. Now, Hubble is powerful, but it's not quite powerful enough to clearly see both the star and the exoplanet as separate objects, which makes it difficult to look at the colour of HD189773b directly. But I am super impressed by how astronomers determined its colour. Here's how they did it. Hubble receives the light from the star and the exoplanet as a single source of light, so the research team compared two combinations of light from the star and the planet. First, when the planet is behind the star, so they only receive starlight. And second, when the planet isn't behind the star, so they receive a combination of light from the star and light reflecting off the planet. When comparing these different combinations of light, scientists noticed that when HD189773b passed behind its star, the amount of blue light detected by Hubble decreased, but all the other colours didn't really change, meaning that the colour of HD189773b is blue. And this blue colour is likely from reflected clouds on HD189773b that contain silicate particles that scatter blue light more than red light. And since this planet orbits quite close to its host star, those silicates get pretty hot and could condense to form small drops of molten glass whizzing around the planet sideways at 8,700 kilometers per hour. Holy sh**. So there you have it, five truly wild exoplanets. The hottest, the one that rains engagement rings, the first circumtriple exoplanet, maybe, the darkest, and the one that rains molten glass sideways. These are just a few in the sea of exoplanets that's getting bigger and bigger every day. But wait, don't go away, because I have a bonus wild exoplanet to share with you. That's right, we're back in the bonus fun fact zone. This bonus exoplanet is similar to GW Orionis in that it hasn't been confirmed yet, so a wild, maybe, exoplanet. But what makes this one wild is that, unlike the others, it's in a completely different galaxy. Like, we've only found planets inside the Milky Way galaxy, never outside, except for maybe now. And it's not a nearby galaxy either, like the Magellanic Clouds or even Andromeda. No, it is in the galaxy M51, also known as the Whirlpool Galaxy, which is 30 million light years away. Now, it's not possible to detect exoplanets in distant galaxies with the methods we use to find them in the Milky Way galaxy because they're just so far away. But this team of researchers proposed a way of finding exoplanets outside the Milky Way galaxy. They propose that exoplanets could be found around X-ray binaries, which are usually a pair of stars, usually made of one regular star and either a neutron star or a black hole. Now, often what happens in systems like these is that the neutron star or black hole, with their immense gravitational pull, slurp up material from their stellar buddy, the regular star. And as that material falls onto the neutron star or black hole, it releases lots of X-rays in a thin column or a jet. And by studying changes in the amount of X-ray light we receive from these objects over time, we could potentially spot possible planets if they block some of the X-rays from our perspective. It's a lot like the transit method, which is used to find exoplanets in the Milky Way galaxy. When a planet passes in front of its host star from our perspective, we see a dip in the visible light from the star, but instead of visible light dipping, it's X-ray light. And this team thinks that they've found one, an exoplanet in the Whirlpool Galaxy 30 million light years away. At least this dip in X-ray light they observed can't be explained by any other sources other than a planet in transit in which the eclipser is most likely to be the size of Saturn. Now, we may not confirm it is indeed an exoplanet for a little while though, because its orbit is estimated to take about 70 years. So we'd have to wait at least another 70 years to potentially see the planet block the X-rays again. But I'm hopeful. Come on, extragalactic exoplanet. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider giving it a like and subscribing for more content, and comment below what other wild objects we should explore next. And if there's another wild exoplanet that you think people should know about, let us know in the comments so we can all learn about wild exoplanets together. Until next time, keep looking up and stay curious.